Julius Hatofsky was a painter, an American painter. He was born in upstate New York, in Ellenville, New York, who lived 83 years from 1922 to 2006. I was with him for 33 of those years. We married in 1994 after he had a stroke, and I was not allowed in his hospital room and decided at that point it was time for us to get married. He was a very dedicated, tirelessly involved painter. He was in high school and he started drawing. And then he received a scholarship to the Art Students League, but unfortunately he couldn't take it because he had to support his family. His father had died when he was three, and his mother had struggled with three children, and he had to work. And he had some of the oddest jobs. He sold socks at Saks Fifth Avenue. He did carpentry work. He was even a policeman, a traffic cop, but he never drove. Finally, he decided to join the army. And he was taken into the 82nd Airborne, and he saw three crucial battles in the Second World War: the Battle of the Bulge, the invasion of Holland, and the invasion of Normandy. And at the end of the war, liberate a concentration camp. He also carried a base plate on his back as a foot soldier. And during that time, when he was carrying that base plate, he would see his comrades falling, injured, dying. And he decided at that point that if he were to ever get out of this war, he would do exactly as he wanted, and that would be to be a painter, but is on his own terms. And indeed he did that. He went to the Art Students League. He had two very important teachers at the Art Student League in his life, and that was Robert Beverly Hale, who was his drawing instructor, and the beloved teacher Morris Cantor. And that was very, very special, and he felt honored that he had those teachers. Then he spent a year in Paris at the Grand Chaumier, and he also came back to work at the Hans Hofmann studios. And then he began to paint. He had the first loft in Hoboken, and he was doing very well. He had shows at a legendary gallery, Charles Egan Gallery. He showed at the Avant-Garde Gallery. He was doing very well. He was even voted one of the 10 most promising painters in New York at that time. And this was in the 50s. But a divorce and his growing disillusionment with the New York art scene absolutely prompted him to move to San Francisco. And so he moved, he got a job at the San Francisco Art Institute, and he taught there for 33 years. He taught drawing and painting. In 1971, he had a studio where I met him, south of Market in San Francisco, and it was a 5,600 square foot studio. Absolutely stunning. And it was one of the first lofts south of Market at that time. In 1974, I moved to San Francisco and moved in with him into this beautiful loft that was very special. And his paintings, some of them 12 by 30 feet, 8 by 10 feet, were all over the loft. His first paintings were very much abstract, very powerful abstract expressionist work. And slowly, the figure began to come into his work. And I think there was a critic who even said that you could see figures in just the beginning of figures in some of the abstract work. And Hilton Kramer described his work at one point as "whirl is king," because Julius's work was turbulent. And it was full of archetypal images and various kinds of of leaping images and undulating images. He began also working with the figure in these images, and you began to see figurative work. He was very, very involved with a number of painters. One of them was William Blake, and Turner, another. I have to say that for many years we used to go to Europe at the end of the year for about 3 weeks, and we used to visit these painters' works in London, in Venice, in Paris, in Spain, and he would take cards, 3x5 cards, and he had this wonderful cigar box with colored pencils in them and 3x5 cards. And we would go to the museums and we would see these marvelous painters' work. And then he would go back to our hotel and he would draw important images that he had seen that day on these cards. And these were studies for larger paintings, but they themselves are beautiful pieces of art. Julius felt that inventing imagery was the basis of his paintings. And after that, he would concentrate on the important painting concerns. Inner light was extremely important, scale, drawing, rhythm, all of these concerns. And sometimes he would call me over as he was working on a particular image and he would show it to me and say, "You see that? I love that image. It's beautiful." Because he was a drawing teacher and he loved the figure, he would have, there would be three or four other teachers and painters who would come over and they would hire a model and he would draw. But one of the things that he loved to do was add other figures. There would be a model, but then he would add many other figures to the drawing, and they became mixed media drawings. And some of them are very, very funny, very erotic. And he loved doing the figure. So he had a huge range that he worked on. And he was very fortunate in that he taught. And so he was able to teach 2 days a week and then paint the rest of the time, which he did. He decided that he wanted to retire after 33 years at the Art Institute. Hundreds and hundreds of students wanted to give him something. And somehow they gathered together $20,000. They said, "Julius, what do you want?" And he said, "I want a catalog." And they created a catalog. They were made with love by the students. Julius, in 1999, contracted cancer. We were unable to be in the loft. And so we bought an old Victorian in Vallejo. And the beauty of this house was that it had huge walls where the paintings could exist, and it also had a basement the length of the house so that many of the paintings are downstairs. And so the house became a kind of museum. He lived for 7 more years and died in 2006.